Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. And here's the verse we're going to focus on. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. And I'll use the word to inquire of him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of a sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God my Savior. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, or hope for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and hope for the Lord. So far, the reading of God's word. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, as we open your word today, pray, Lord, that we will receive what you have for us. Help us, Lord, to be open to what you would say. And I pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth, meditations of my heart may be glorifying to you as I share. We pray this in your name. Amen. And as you can all tell, my voice is still off, and I'm still... But I was determined to do this because Pastor Aaron worked hard this summer. As you know, I've been off most of the summer. And I was like, I wasn't going to ask Pastor Aaron to take this Sunday. So here I am, but I'm going to have a halt. And I'll kind of stand back here to try not to breathe on you too much. So desire. Think about that, desire. What is your deepest soul desire, your deepest longing? We use the word desire often, we think of sexual desire, but the desire is something that God has given us. And our longings and our desires are originally good. And it's not just limited to sexual desire. What is it that we long for? In Psalm 27, verse 4, the psalmist declares that his greatest desire is to dwell in the house of the Lord, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, and to seek, contemplate, meditate, or inquire. And a lot of versions of the Bible use the word seek, but the root of that is actually to inquire, and that's the focus that we're going to have this morning. To inquire of him in his temple. So David longs for the presence of the Lord. And why is that his soul's deepest desire? And the rest of the psalm shows us why. The psalm is categorized by some scholars as a psalm of both trust and healing. I found that really interesting, that healing is one of the ways that it's often categorized. He longs to live in the presence of the living God because with God, he will be safe and secure, protected from foes both outside himself and within himself. He has no need to be afraid because God is his stronghold. He can trust God and hope in God because God has proven himself to be faithful. To dwell, to gaze, and inquire of the Lord also is, according to Kurt Thompson, he uses the words to be seen and soothed. And that's not as explicit in the psalm as safe and secure, but it's implied. God knows his circumstances, knows his fears of being overcome by his enemies, of being overwhelmed by trouble, of being rejected by God, of his reputation being destroyed by gossip. But he doesn't hide what's really going on inside himself, where he really finds himself. He seeks to be safe and secure, but also seen and soothed or comforted. For the living God to say, it's okay, I see you. I know what's happening in your life, and yet I will never leave you or forsake you. You can with confidence trust and hope in me. God is the God who sees. And Hagar says that when she is sent to the desert with her son by Abraham, right? She says, you are the God who sees me. So the words seen, soothed, secure, and safe, those are the words that Dr. Thompson, the author of The Soul of Desire, uses. And he suggests that as human beings, our deepest desire is to be these four things, to be seen, to be known, to be soothed, comforted, to be safe and secure. And he suggests that ultimately we are seen, soothed, safe, and secure when we truly dwell, gaze, and inquire of the Lord, as David describes in verse 4. And out of this, beauty is created. And it's created out of the shame and trauma and brokenness of our lives. Not by covering over what's broken in our lives, but actually out of acknowledging it, beauty comes out of it. And he actually writes, as I said, an entire book on this. And as you can tell, it really impacted me. But before we get into the details of what it means to dwell and gaze and inquire, let's consider whether this is an individual or a communal endeavor. Often when we think of this verse, and that includes me, I've thought about it as David dwelling and gazing and inquiring of the Lord. And it's between him and God. But is it really just between him and God? And Dr. Thompson does a thread of the narrative of Scripture, which most of us are actually aware of, and we have talked about in different ways, but we haven't necessarily, or at least I haven't necessarily, put it together in quite the way he has. He describes a movement. So initially you have the house of the Lord, which was the tabernacle, right? Or a tent of meeting at Shiloh. And that's where God's presence was. And then you have the construction of Solomon's temple in Jerusalem, and God's presence was there. And that was destroyed in 586 before Christ by the Babylonians. And then the next temple was built. And then when Jesus came, and it's of this second temple where God's presence was considered to be as well, that he says that he will destroy this temple and raise it again in 3 days. It says that in John. And Jesus also speaks, this is familiar to us, right? He speaks of how he will dwell with each of us in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit, whose arrival he commands his followers to wait on at the end of John, right? At the end of the Gospels. And in 1 Corinthians, Paul writes how Jesus' followers are the body of Christ, each being an indispensable part. Jesus' body is the temple, and we are Jesus' body. Hence, we are the temple in which we are to dwell. Does that follow? Ephesians 2 says, in him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. So if we long to dwell in the house of the Lord, We long to dwell with God's people. Then in Revelation 3, it says, each of us as a pillar of beauty in the temple in the city of God. So we move from encountering the beauty of something outside of ourselves, the temple, the tabernacle, to the beauty of the person of Jesus and our interaction with him, to the beauty that we ourselves become, first as members of Jesus' body and then as the very structural supports within the holy city. To put it another way, if Jesus is the temple and he now dwells within us in the presence of the Holy Spirit, to dwell in the house of the Lord is to live intimately in the presence of other God followers. We are the house of the Lord, not this building. We as a community. So let's look a little bit more closely at these verbs, dwell, gaze, inquire. To dwell requires, when you dwell, you live there, and it requires tending. It takes time and attention. You can't do it in a moment, right? Marie just talked about how she knocked her deck, right? It takes maintenance. It takes time, attention to dwell somewhere, to be somewhere. You're staying put. You're not taking off. Culturally, we tend to want to go everywhere. And if we don't like something, we say, we'll go somewhere else. And we don't, as a culture, dwell very well in a spot. As soon as something happens that we don't like or that somebody we disagree with, we walk out the door. And there's even within our own denomination now, right? There's that kind of stuff happening. Where people are like, you got to agree with me or I'm leaving. We don't dwell well together so often. It takes time and effort and presence. A willingness to dwell with hard things over a long period of time, suggests Thomas, without giving up on each other. So to gaze at the beauty of the Lord. Now, beauty, you know, I don't think much about beauty often, but I think I'm sold after reading this book that beauty is very crucial, and that beauty is something that heals us and transforms us. When we gaze on an object of beauty, it is to present and look upon it on its own terms, not on ours. We allow beauty to enrapture us and carry us to peaks and troughs of what it means for us to be human. And we long to linger with it, yearning to stop the clock on a spectacular sunset, sensing ourselves to be mysteriously transformed by it. And those are Thomas's words, not mine. So if we are the dwelling place of God, and if we are the body and face of Jesus, then by extension we reflect the very beauty of God upon which we gaze. So we gaze on each other, and we see the image of God in each other. We talk about that sometimes, right? That each of us has the image of God in us. And then over time, all this stuff sort of covers it up, all the crap of life. And yeah, it is crap. I could say worse words, but everything in life covers it up. And then we have trouble seeing the actual beauty of that who we were created to be, the image of God in us. But as we gaze at each other and take the time to truly see each other, the beauty becomes clear. I'm not saying that we're actually God, but we see the resemblance of our Father in each other's faces, revel in the Spirit's joyful transformation of us as individuals, and as a community in each other's stories of new creation. And this gazing on each other with the intent of seeing the beauty of God in each of us is actually in the context of the reality of our shame and trauma and brokenness and suffering and sin. All the distortion of our God-given desires. And beauty comes out of the ashes. Think of Good Friday. Good Friday, we call it good, but what makes it good? Good Friday itself is a day of horror, absolute, complete horror. Jesus is nailed to the cross. He is humiliated. He's shamed. He is hanging on the cross. He's suffering. So how is that good? How is that good? But out of the horror of Good Friday comes the beauty of the resurrection. So it's through the horror that we see the beauty. So when we dwell with each other and gaze on each other with the love of Christ, we don't hide our shame, our many layers of trauma and sin and sufferings, but we stay the course, and the transformational power of gazing and being gazed upon with intention and love in the very presence of our hideousness, think about that, our hideousness, becomes the solid ground on which beauty is created out of the shame and mess of our lives. Isaiah 61, which is the part of the passage that is our passage as a congregation, says, bestow a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Our shame makes us want to hide. And if you think you have no shame in your life, just sit for a while. I spent some time last week, and I made a list. And to be honest, I'm ashamed of how long the list is. And I'm not kidding about that. Shame destroys. And we all have shame of some kind that makes us want to hide. But being truly seen, gazing on the beauty of God's image within us brings life and beauty. Telling our stories more truly is loving each other, gazing on each other, dwelling with each other. We dwell, we gaze. And we do so in order to inquire in the Lord's temple. And it's inquiring that we take the steps of creating beauty and goodness out of the traumas and tragedies of our life. To inquire is to be curious, not only of others, but of ourselves, and to allow others to do the same. And so God is a curious God, and he often asks questions throughout Scripture. And two of the questions that I'm going to just bring up today is, where are you? Adam and Eve were asked that question. Sure, they were in the woods or in the bush or wherever. They were hiding, right? They were hiding from God and from each other. They were ashamed and they were afraid. And they were telling each other stories in their heads about God and each other, which wasn't necessarily true. But don't we do that so often? Tell ourselves stories in our heads about ourselves and about other people constantly? Where are you? Where are you in relationship to yourself, to each other, to God? And the second question is, what do you want? What is your deepest desire? And Dr. Thompson suggests that we actually have a very limited practice in naming our longings to be seen, soothed, safe, and secure. But naming them leads us to hope. But it's also a lot of hard work to do. And out of his practice, created what they call confessional communities. These are communities of people who agree to stick together no matter what, and to get to know each other, and to gaze at each other, and to dwell with each other as the layers of all the trauma and shame and crap of life get taken off. But to do so in an atmosphere of love, of acceptance, of gazing, so that beauty, transformation can come out of that. And I was part of a community a number of years ago, which was a spiritual direction community, like it was about 10 of us. And so we met every 2 weeks, and this is essentially what we did. And for me, it was transformational. But I will say that the very first meeting that we gathered, we did this for 10 months, every 2 weeks. Very first meeting, I shared something that was quite personal and was difficult for me, and then the next person talked about how bored he was. Wow, that triggered me. And I walked out of the room. And then I was embarrassed and ashamed for having walked out of the room. But I paid a lot of money for this, and I wasn't about to give that up. So the next time I did come back, and the power of talking it through and not simply just walking away was incredible. It was transformational. That's, I think, what this is talking about. When we gaze at each other in a space where we are honest, but where we also, it's a space where we can feel secure and safe and soothed and seen. Avenue, we do this in bits and pieces, right? Do I feel completely safe up here? To be honest, not entirely. When we do sharing Sundays, people share. And people share quite honestly. And that is kind of part of what I'm talking about. When we share around tables, often people share honestly. We're in house churches. But we have to stay together and be in relationship with each other long enough to actually have this happen for the long haul. So I'm going to ask you to come around tables, if you're not already around tables, and I'm going to ask you two questions. Actually, there's one picture I want to show you first. Yeah. So this is, I forget what the name of it is, a Japanese, some of you who are artists. Yes, thank you. So it's the idea that when something is broken, you don't just throw it away. You actually mend it, and in the actual broken pieces is where you put something precious, and it creates beauty out of the brokenness. And that's what God does with our lives. So I'd like you to come around tables, and there's two questions. Where do you find yourself this morning? And what do you want? What is your deepest desire? Now, only share as much as you're comfortable with, right? We never want people to share more than they're comfortable with, because we do need to feel safe and secure in order to share, right? But think about it. If you're feeling like you can't really share anything, ask yourself, why is that? What is going on in my own life? Okay? But share as you feel comfortable. So I invite you to go around tables.